So good morning, everybody. First of all, thank you, of course, to the organizers, especially Kitja, for having me over here and this very, very, very generous welcome. I feel a bit humble now, actually. So I have about 45 minutes, and I know that we are already a bit late, so I'll try to keep it condensed. Perhaps one of you could tell me, when I still have 10 minutes left, could you give me a sign? Yeah, just make sure that we have some time management here. So I'll largely be talking from my book, Installation Art and the Museum, and actually Kitja was also quite important in the publication of that book because she assisted me in helping out to find all the copyrights for all the images, which is quite, as you know, quite a laborious task. So just to be clear, I'm not a conservator nor a curator. So my role is to study museum practices of presentation and conservation. That's my background. And I do that through ethnographic research, and I'll tell a little bit more about what that means. And my goal is, through that research, to understand decision-making processes and also to understand better how attitudes towards change of artworks in a museum context are currently developing. And they're developing as a response to the challenges presented by contemporary artistic forms, the topic of today's symposium. So before I start, I would just very briefly walk you through a couple of international projects which I was lucky enough to be part of. Of course, probably most of you will know Modern Art, Who Cares? And since then there have been many conferences and symposiums and research projects which deal with the challenges of contemporary arts conservation. And it's really become a kind of topic both in museum studies but also in academia. And so from the 90s onwards, it's finally was on the agenda. And it's, I think what is very interesting also about this particular field is that it's, on the one hand, it's very collaborative, conservators and curators thinking together to bring this field forward. And it's also very international. Of course, it started with some curators in museums who thought, well, actually, these challenges that we are facing on a kind of individual level, these questions and challenges are shared by many in different museums in different countries. So let's bring that together, bring all these people together to think collectively about these challenges and really put it on the agenda. And one of the, I think, quite important projects in that respect was Inside Installation Art. There's a book, 2012, and Glenn Wharton is one of the authors there also. This is a name that you will hear quite frequent. And Inside Installation Art had as its kind of core, they invited several curators and conservators to bring in their most problematic case, installation artworks. So the research consists of 33 case studies. So it's really this kind of case-based approach, and that's also, I think, part of the kind of the background of today's symposium, that we will be talking about cases. And that's also how conservation theory and practices emerge, is through these case-based research. And so by looking at different cases and getting the kind of the questions and the challenges through each of those cases and comparing those cases, through which practice and theory develops. So that's also the kind of approach that I took, not as a conservator, but looking at conservation practices through a case-based exploration. As you can see, this project was funded by the EU, and several of the projects have been generously funded by the EU and also by the National Center for Science in the Netherlands. This is another project that I was involved in, New Strategies in the Conservation of Contemporary Art, a collaboration also with the University of Amsterdam and with Instituut Collectie Nederland, which is now the Dutch Heritage Agency of the Netherlands. So these are also kind of key partners in this process. From this project, this was really a kind of a more theoretical research, organized by, or coordinated also by universities. But we also had a couple of conservators who were doing their research as a PhD. And Sonneke Stichter, for example, recently defended her PhD on conceptual art. It's not published yet, but I hope it will be published soon, because it's a very interesting book to read. Collecting the Performative, I understood that Louise will talk a little bit more also about this project. This was a collaboration with Tate. Pip Laurenson was the main, the PI, the principal investigator, really focusing on performance art. And this was interesting because it was a collaboration between a university, Maastricht University, and Tate as a museum. So also throughout my story, you can probably sense this kind of really interesting collaborations between universities, academia, and museums, and what that kind of collaboration allows us to do in terms of thinking and bringing the practice forward. NACCH, New Approaches in the Conservation of Contemporary Arts, recently started. Coordinator is René van der Val. And over this last year, I've been coordinating the project, but luckily René van der Val is back again and she has taken over the project again, which gives me a bit more time to do some research, which is also nice. An interesting project because it involves 15 PhD candidates in several institutions within Europe, working on contemporary art issues that have up till now been under theorized, so to say. And the NACCH PhD candidates on the picture, you'll probably see some of them over the next years. They'll be working on their PhDs for about 3 years. And then so after 3 years, we have hopefully 15 new PhD works, 15 theses on this topic. And I think this project as well, it's amazing that the EU has funded this project. It involves also training for the PhD candidates. The next school, the winter school, will be in... Did I lose you? The next winter school will be at the Tate. Is this better?
Yes.
The next winter school will be at Tate, and there will also be some public presentations. So if you are in London or around, then you're very welcome to join us for that. So, studying practices. That's going to be my topic for today. And I'll talk also about these key concepts, but I do also, I read the booklet, The Incomplete Guide, and these little kind of vignettes about particular concepts are really interesting. So I decided not to really focus on a lot of these concepts, not to give you definitions in a way, but more to talk about or to introduce a kind of different way of thinking about concepts. And I'll be talking about a case study by Namjoon Paik and particularly looking at authenticity. So as said, I study the challenges presented by new artistic forms, installation art, time-based media, and performance. And my theoretical framework is the notion of the biography. In earlier work, I call this the career, the artwork's career. And this notion of biography is helpful because it allows you to study the trajectories of artworks. So instead of thinking like more traditional art historical thinking, thinking about the artwork or analyzing the artwork as a fixed material object. That's how art history tends to look at artworks. Instead of looking at artworks as fixed material objects, thinking about their trajectories. And so thinking about artworks having a biography allows you to study the processes of these artworks. Allows you to study maybe different stages of artworks when they're in storage or when they're being installed, when they are being acquired by museums and entering this kind of environment of care. Now, all these different stages in these environments have a particular impact on the artwork, and they change throughout these processes. And of course, although the artwork has an agency itself, and that's a notion, and the notion of agency, a material agency, something that Glenn Wharton also refers to, a recent, very interesting article also by Fernando Dominguez about the agency of artworks and how materiality also affects the changes of these works. But of course, these changes also occur through the hands of curators, conservators, decision-making processes. So, talking about the biography of artworks, my kind of main argument today, and I'll come back to that later, is that a work's continuity, and notice that I don't use authenticity here, a work's continuity is created by establishing, maintaining, and severing relations between various stages in its biography. So talking about reconstruction is also talking about continuity. And this continuity is often understood, or documentation is considered to be a means in order to achieve that continuity. So studying artworks also means, or studying artworks in the process as part of these museum practices also means a different methodology in terms of an academic kind of a methodology. So here I found during my research that indeed art history, but also museum studies, was limited in a way that I couldn't really trace these processes and these practices in which these artworks take part. So I adopted from anthropology the method of ethnography. And I spent a lot of time in museums observing what was going on, talking to conservators, curators, directors, guards, all these actors who are involved in the museum, studying what was going on, and what kind of decisions were they taking, and where did they kind of base those decisions on. So ethnography, a set of methods that involves the ethnographer, that was me, participating overtly or covertly in people's daily lives for an extended period of time, watching what happens, listening to what is said, asking questions, in fact, collecting whatever data are available to throw light on the issues that are the focus of the research. So I was I took on the identity of an ethnographer doing participant research, and more I started really from a kind of observing role, and more, which happens quite often in ethnography, I became more of a participant and doing participant observation. And I think the project like Collecting the Performative, which I mentioned early, is an example where my role was not only reflecting as a kind of outsider on what was going on, but also participating in these practices. So here too, these kind of boundaries between practice and theory are much less clear than we sometimes tend to take. So the benefits of doing ethnography, studying the biography of artworks asked for a different methodology. So I was interested in how artworks are shaped in museum practices, but also how museum practices and museum institutions shape artworks. So it was really about this co-shaping between the museum, or the co-shaping of museums and the co-shaping of artworks in a kind of network environment. And in order to study these artworks, then we also have to foreground practices. So in my case, museum practices of collecting and conservation functioned as a lens to study the shaping of artworks and museums. And the focus of this is that how key concepts such as authenticity, and I'll be talking about that today, are kind of enacted in practices. So I won't be looking at clear-cut definitions. That's also part of scholarly work, I think, to provide understandable definitions. But instead of doing that, I will really look at how authenticity is, so to say, done in practices. So how curators and conservators are enacting authenticity. So instead of thinking about authenticity as something inherent to an object, I'm looking at how authenticity is done in practice. This notion of traveling concepts is a notion from Mika Ball, And I think it's relevant here because talking about these key concepts which are still very apparent in conservation and also still frequently used, of course these concepts such as artist intent, integrity, authenticity, their meaning changes, right? Their meaning changes over time through different contexts as well. And I think this is something that really needs to be studied in more depth, actually. How are these concepts used in daily practice? How do definitions or how do people understand these concepts today? And how is that maybe different if you look at the types of actors and their interests? So curators, conservators, and it's really great that we have both actors here today. So traveling concepts travel between disciplines, between individuals, scholars, between historical periods, and between geographically dispersed academic communities. And their meaning obviously changes. So like the artworks that we're studying, also these definitions and these concepts are changing. Well, a very familiar name, of course, for all of you. I just wanted to kind of bring this the notion of minimal intervention into the arena, and also this notion of reversibility, because of course these are two of the kind of core concepts that are still very meaningful in conservation, and especially more kind of the classical thinking, the scientific thinking of conservation. But it's also something that I think many of the conservators were kind of trained to take these notions into consideration and take them really serious, but as said, also contemporary art challenges these notions. So just looking at the principle of reversibility, being able to undo what you have previously done, indicating a more careful approach towards decisions and destructive effects of interventions in the original material. This was already introduced in 1961 in the Codes of Ethics. But of course, thinking about contemporary art really challenges this notion of reversibility. So this is one of the things I think and I hope that we will also be talking about today in more depth. Integrity, another very complex and interesting concept. This is a definition provided by Ashley Smith. Integrity of the artwork has been defined as including evidence of its origins, its original constitution, the materials of which it is composed, and information which it may embody as to its maker's intentions and the technology used in its manufacture. And so integrity here is really understood in its kind of material meaning. Authenticity, that's the concept that I would like to explore further today. An artwork is authentic when the object is true to its origins. This is one of the definitions of authenticity. Authenticity also suggests a direct relation to the past and its maker. And authenticity obviously is strongly connected to monetary value as well as to power relationships. Throughout the literature, these kind of different forms of authenticity have been distinguished: historical authenticity, conceptual authenticity, and I'm introducing them just very briefly here because they will also play a role in the case study that I will be exploring later on. I'm sorry, the last sentence is not readable. It should say, the object's history is erased and the object is brought back into its presumed original state, creating an illusion. And for the case study that we'll be looking at, I'll be particularly focusing on material authenticity and conceptual authenticity. So let's very briefly go to this kind of original, the more traditional way of thinking about conservation, which underpinned by traditional artworks. And this has been labeled as a scientific or a classical conservation, and Salvador Muñoz Finas is one of the well, conservation theorists who have kind of introduced the idea that there are different paradigms in conservation, and we're moving from a scientific, classical kind of conservation paradigm to a more contemporary paradigm. The scientific classical conservation is based on the assumptions that the principal aim of conservation is to preserve the integrity of the object. So here, this notion of integrity comes back. And that this integrity is located in the object's physical features and constituents. And last but not least, the best way to preserve the integrity of the object is through the application of science. So within this kind of classical conservation framework, and I don't want to imply that this framework is now completely abandoned in favor of a more contemporary paradigm. I think we are more in a kind of stage where both paradigms or both frameworks are still very much in place, and also, although there are tensions, they also relate to each other in different ways. So instead of moving from one paradigm to the other, I think these are still kind of both still accurate. So authenticity and intention in this classical conservation framework are understood in terms of freezing the object at a certain moment in time, and this idea that the ideal state is the original state. So it kind of presupposes a static object. And Pip Laurenson, along with Glenn Wharton and René van der Val, for example, Pip Laurenson is another actor, I think, in a way, in the sense that she, coming from Tate, she really kind of was challenged to think about her own role within the museum in a different way. And in order to think about that different role, she turned to theory to understand her role better, but also to understand this new paradigm better. And recently, we have been fortunate at Maastricht University to give her a position as a special chair in collection care, which again is an example, I think, of this really interesting collaboration between universities and museums, and where theory and practice really feed each other and learn from each other. I'm sure you're familiar with a seminal article by Pip Laurenson on authenticity, and this is a quote from her: "Change is understood in reference to the state of the object, and change which is irreversible and undesirable is defined as damage or loss." And this damage or loss, I think is still very present in contemporary thinking about, for example, reproductions or reconstructions. We tend to think about, so what is lost in these reconstructions? But of course, you could also look at it in a more kind of positive way, in terms of thinking about what is produced within these reproductions. So instead of thinking about loss only, we also think about these processes and practices in terms of what is gained. And I think this rethinking from loss to gain also relates to the role of curators and conservators, in the sense that reflecting on their own role within these processes becomes more and more important. Because these decision-making and the handling, the things that they do, has an effect on how these artworks change and how these works are brought into the future, and not only thinking about change in terms of loss. And that's, I think, a very important shift in thinking, and that change is not something that needs to be necessarily avoided, but that conservation is more and more considered as, now I lost my thread, so that conservation is more and more considered also as something that is productive in a way. So, moving on to the case study. And for those who maybe have read my book, this might be a familiar case study. Nam June Paik, this is a work, One Candle, which I saw for the first time in the Deutsche Guggenheim in 2004. And when talking to the conservator of the MMK, the Modern Art Museum in Frankfurt, he actually was considering to suggest One Candle as one of his problematic cases in the Inside Installation project, the first project that I mentioned in the introduction. So he thought, because the work was part of the collection in Frankfurt, he wanted to bring this work in as a case study. But when we were talking about it, I thought, I've seen this work in the Deutsche Guggenheim, but it's a completely different work than that the conservator was describing. So I got a bit puzzled. How was this then a different version, or was it a reconstruction or a reproduction, or what was this installation in the Deutsche Guggenheim? That's also when I started to look into this case study in more depth. And this is an image from the work in the MMK, and the story goes that Nam June Paik was invited when the museum was established. The artist was invited to choose a space, and he chose the broom cupboard. And so instead of choosing a really nice gallery space, he chose the smallest room in the museum, which was actually not designed to be an exhibition space, but he chose this small triangular room. And you see a burning candle, a video. It's not recorded, but it's kind of immediately projected on the walls, and you see these kind of dinosaur projectors, the beamers. And this one was actually signed by Paik. But of course, these equipment become obsolete, and this is an image, it's not very good. It's too light, actually. But here, there are some beamers here, but they're still with the cathode ray beamers, but they are more, advanced in comparison to the older ones. And here is, you can see the comparison. This is the Deutsche Guggenheim. It was a big space. I think twice the size of this space. And this was a very intimate kind of small room where you had to be by yourself to experience the work, and coming into the room, the candlelight would flicker slightly. So very intimate, almost like a kind of a cathedral. This, however, in this large building, also called One Candle, or in this large room, a completely different experience. So how could it be that these two works existed simultaneously? And one of the things that I want to kind of, or what I tried also to explain in my book, is that this notion of singularity, the notion of an artwork being singular, being unique, being a kind of fixed object, becomes problematic when you start to look at practices. So when you start to look at what actually happened with this work, and then you will see that, for example, all the original materials have already been replaced, right? You would also see that, interestingly, there is this narrative within the museum that Nam June Paik came to the museum, he installed the work, and this is one of the few installation artworks by Nam June Paik that has not been removed or reinstalled. So it's really still connected to the artist in that way. But when I did my research at the MMK, I found out that actually the work was deinstalled at one time. And there was another work in that same space, and then a couple of months later, One Candle was reinstalled again. But that was kind of, it was gone from the institutional memory, and nobody remembered it. There was only one guard who kind of, he told me that this actually took place, and everybody denied. But then I found indeed in the documentation, the institution's plans, that indeed the work was deinstalled and reinstalled by somebody else later, not by Nam June Paik. So all these narratives, these kind of the mechanisms of singularity are really in place at the Museum of Modern Art in Frankfurt. Another kind of mechanism that enforces this notion of singularity is that apparently, when studying the work, actually One Candle was on display at lots of different venues. But interestingly, when I wanted to find the images of these, the catalogues of these all these different installations, every time and again, it was the image of one candle at the MMK that was published in these catalogues. So again, this is a kind of a mechanism that reinforces the singularity, the uniqueness of this one candle at the MMK. But parallel to this singularity, there is also this repertoire of multiplicity of artworks, which are constantly kind of reconstructed at different venues. The reconstruction, and this is important to mention, how much time do I still have? 5 minutes? Okay. So it's important to mention that this reconstruction was possible because this work was asked to go on loan quite frequently, and the loan request went to the curator of the MMK. And the curator then contacted one of the assistants of Namjoon Paik, Johan Sauerakker, and he installed the work at different venues. So instead of shipping the one candle at the MMK to these different venues, Johan Sauerakker hired equipment and installed the work at these different venues. So there are kind of two parallel developments here. On the one hand, the singular one candle in the collection of the MMK, and on the other hand, these multiple one candles at remote venues. And these two practices could coexist because the curator and the conservator, of course, they were in touch with each other, but the conservator was looking or had taken care of the one candle at the MMK, and the curator was taking care of these loans. So also in the work division, kind of the work division allowed these two different practices to coexist. And it wasn't really known. Even the director of the MMK didn't realize that there were so many one candles at different points. Well, another example, Berlin 2007. So to wrap up, one candle as singular, mechanisms and arguments that bring the repertoire of singularity into play. And I think this notion of singularity, and that's my main point, is that within the museum, all these mechanisms as part of the museum structures and the museum logic really enforce or reinforce this notion of the artwork as being unique, it's original. On the other hand, if you look at the actual practices, or the things that are going on, then you see that one candle is also multiple. But the repertoire, so the repertoire of singularity only holds as long as practices like these, this notion that actually the work was taken out of this room and reinstalled. This repertoire of singularity only holds as long as you take these practices, if you don't look at the practices. Thinking about reconstruction, I just want to bring in two different paradigms. And René van der Val, professor also at Maastricht University, she's writing a book at the moment, and she's thinking about these different paradigms, and this is part of her work in progress, so it hasn't been published yet. But one of the paradigms, like beyond the scientific paradigm that she has introduced, is the performance paradigm. And in this case, works are defined by a set of instructions or a score, like performances can also be re-performed based on instructions. They can be recreated by others. And it involves interpretation. They are thickly or thinly described or defined. And this analog to notated music or theater, where there is an existing text, and these works can be re-performed. On the other hand, the processual paradigm is kind of a different paradigm where also works can be brought into the future, but not based on a score or script, because they maybe no longer exist. But there are certain rules, so the artwork has particular rules or work-defining properties, and these reconstructions are based on these rules of the game. And then, of course, it's important to understand as a conservator or curator what the rules of the game are. And this is analog more to improvised music, where there is no notation or no script. and the it's more open-ended, so to say, than the performance paradigm. So these are two notions that I want to bring in here, and hopefully we can return to them later. To wrap up, and again, this is the Apple conversion, I'm afraid. But to wrap up, going back to the biography of artworks, so what I tried to do is to illustrate how these how continuity is is important, of course, and also how if the changes are too abrupt or too quick, if there is no line of continuity, then we no longer speak about the artwork being the same artwork. So in order to be able to talk about the artwork as being the same artwork, this notion of continuity is very important. And there are different mechanisms, again, in the museum, how this continuity is performed through documentation, through materiality, but also, for example, through a continued engagement from the artist. In the incomplete guide, there is the example of Tracy Emin coming to the museum to make up her bed time and again. So the artist continued engagement also enforces that continuity. And in the case of Namjoon Paik, it was Jochen Sauer Akker, the assistant, following the rules of... So this is, I think, where I want to leave you, and I hope the example of one candle and also opening up a kind of a framework where we no longer think of authenticity as inherent to an artwork, but really as something that is being performed, and being performed by you as curators and conservators, and that you're actually actors within that that reconstruction, and also ways then to reflect on your actions. In the interest of time, I don't know whether there is still time for maybe one question, or do you want to leave that to the panel discussion?
I think we should have questions maybe from the audience.
Sure.
If you could go back to the processual art slide and maybe spend 1 minute talking about that.
Yeah, so this is the idea of processual paradigm is based on the idea that there are also artworks are being reperformed and reconstructed with where there is no score or notation. So there might be materiality left, or it could also be that an artwork has kind of within its conceptual framework the notion of process. And this is an example of Anne-Lee, Philippe Barreno and Pierre Week, where they acquired this image of Anne-Lee and asked other artists to make works using that image or using her as a figure. So in a way they kind of gave the control to other artists to make different artworks, which also became part of the process of Amdina. So this is, I think, could be an example of the processual paradigm where there is a particular process which is set in motion by the artist, but where it ends, and they have been trying to end it, but they didn't succeed, and there are still artists, not on invitation by Pierre Week and Philippe Arena, although Tino Sehgal, for example, quite recently also was still used on Lee. So this is a process that at some point was set in motion and it's still continuing. Other actors are involved, not only the artists anymore, but also, new artists or curators or conservators, and also the museum acquiring works like this. So there's no script, there's no score, there's nothing written down for others to continue the process, but the work is still, so the biography of the work is still continued, and the works are still kind of, new works are created, but also the works are changing in that respect. Other questions? Is there a question there? Okay. Thank you very much for your attention, and I wish you a very fruitful day, and I look forward also to the wrapping up at the end of this undoubtedly very productive day. So thank you.